and welcome to Politics Today. I'm Farooq Pitafi. And viewers, once again today we are going to talk about the Panama Papers case that is being heard in the Supreme Court of Pakistan. And the hearing is going on day-to-day basis. So we are going to try and bring the maximum output from the hearing. We are going to discuss what happened, what is going to happen in coming days. Today, it seemed that PTI's learned counsel was struggling in front of the bench, and that probably is because the bench actually observed that while PTI has submitted a lot of documents, at this moment they haven't been able to connect the dots that they have been trying to, and that's why they have asked, because there is this degree of confusion that all of a sudden from London flats there is a jump to Hudaybiyah paper mills, another very interesting case of alleged money laundering. So today there was discussion on that. We are going to ask about that too. And then recently the government passed an ordinance on plea bargain. So we are going to ask our panelists today also whether it is going to have any effect on Panama Papers case. In order to help us understand all these matters, we have with us Zahram Khan Saab, a columnist, a social, civil society activist. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Kamran Khan Saab, a journalist, bureau chief of his channel, and someone who has been covering Supreme Court for quite some time. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. And Kamran Khan Saab, I have to start with you. Because there is something very interesting that is going on. We know that the hearing continued for quite some time in the dying days of the previous year. And then there was this decision that there is going to be a reset because there is going to be a new bench that is going to be constituted. All of a sudden, we thought at that time the court had said that the onus lies on the Sharif family to prove their innocence or at least the money trail. Reset comes, we think that the onus is going to be on the accuser again. Then there was observation that onus again lies on Sharif families, and today we see that they are saying that the onus now lies once again on the accuser. So what exactly is going on?
Well, it is very interesting situation, mm-hmm. and the proceeding. And you talked about the previous decision, mm-hmm. of lastly constituted bench, mm-hmm. I mean, which was headed by the then Chief Justice Anwar Zahid Jamali sahab, mm-hmm. and that was a very sudden decision, mm-hmm. because the when that bench was dissolved, it was said that the incumbent Chief Justice is going to retire on 31st of December, mm-hmm. so that's why a new Chief Justice will be given a chance to constitute a new bench, and the it will be a de novo trial. De novo means it will start from zero point. Okay. So in December, almost 10 to 11 hearings were conducted. Mm-hmm. So that was very sudden decision because Chief Justice knew that he was going to retire. Why did he conducted all these 11 or 10 hearings?
Maybe because at the end he realized that there's still a lot to be done, so that's why he decided.
Exactly. I'm coming to that point.
But this point about onus, burden of proof. Now, where does it lie? On PTI or the government?
General jurisprudence says that the onus of proving innocence lies on the defendant. Mm-hmm. That is why Imran Khan said that it is the duty of the opposition to level allegation, mm-hmm. to accuse a person, and it is on the onus is on the defendant to prove his innocence.
In the parliament maybe, but not in the court.
No, but no. I mean, this onus is being shifted on. On both the parties.
At this moment, my concern or the confusion that I have is, it might be shifted from one person to another. But why is the court changing its opinion We have seen two opinions already. So this is what I was asking, but let me welcome the third guest who has just joined us, Jana Chakzai Saab, representing the ruling party, Pakistan Muslim League. Nawaz, one of the experts who would quarrel with me than to actually make his point, but thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Kamran Khansab, allow me to actually take this discussion a bit forward and bring in Zahram Khansab. So what do you make of this shifting onus?
I think there has been some confusion in this point from the very beginning. And we must remember it's a public interest litigation case. It's not a criminal trial.
It is not.
And public interest litigation starts on some constitutional point. Not as a criminal investigation, and Supreme Court is not a criminal court.
It is not.
It does not carry out investigation in any a criminal case. There has to be some investigation to help the court. Here, constitutional court is hearing a case without any help from any investigative body. And as far as the onus is concerned, in a normal court and in a normal procedure, the onus is always on the prosecution.
Okay.
It's for the prosecution to prove any wrongdoing.
Okay.
In some cases, and in cases of some institutions, and those institutions also have investigative authority. This investigative bit is very important because investigation is the first step of a criminal process, and we are looking at it from a criminal prism or a criminal angle. So that now the other route, I mean, it either could be NAB law or NAB institution like NAB. It could be any investigative authority, or then it could be any special body, investigative body formed by the court. Special bench or special
and thing. We were nearing that point when they decided that they are going to start from scratch.
We were nearing that point. That was the point. Under prevalent, under existing law of evidence, you cannot ask any accused to provide proof against himself. That would be against the spirit of law.
Okay.
That would be against the law of evidence.
Okay.
So court cannot.
So they cannot implicate themselves.
They cannot implicate themselves.
They can furnish any document that is required by the court.
And there is an of course
demanded by the court.
Whatever.
Even if it implicates them.
Look, it is the final court. Whatever it says is very important.
That is true.
But important thing is, people can be asked to furnish evidence against themselves. When they are when they hold public offices, and when they are being investigated by a body which is responsible for oversight, but I think it would be very difficult because the blame is not on the Prime Minister but his family members who hold no office.
And technically, it is not quite a blame either. It is still a petition, and we don't know what becomes of it.
True.
But Jana Chakzai Saab, is your party, is your government satisfied with the proceedings at this moment? I ask because today I saw another very interesting comment coming from Mushahidullah Khan Saab. It was about a different case, a maid who has been brutalized by somebody, her employer. But the story has brought to the fore one character, the owner or employer was actually a judge. So there was this implicit, complaint kind of statement coming from Mushahidullah Khan. I just thought that I'll ask you. If the government is satisfied with the proceedings.
Well, I am not aware of that statement so far, but today's hearing was very interesting. You have heard that, and we were expecting on the allegations of money laundering, some sort of smoking gun, a concrete proof by the PTI's solicitor or lawyer. But he came up with this document saying that it was written by Ishaq Dar, the finance minister under Musharraf era, which everybody knows was obtained under duress and which has no legal stand. And you know, here we saw bankruptcy of its legality of that allegation, i.e. the money laundering that PTI has been saying all along, day in and day out.
So you're saying that the PTI's counsel is actually pivoting away from the main point that they were trying to make?
Well, that was the main accusation, that A, the money has ill-gotten, it has a corruption source, B, that there has been some sort of money laundering. Mm-hmm. Now, they have to come up with some sort of evidence, unless you expect Nawaz Sharif Saab, the Prime Minister, saying that, yes, I have money laundered, unless you expect, you know, under the bar of, you know, evidence.
Maybe PTI does expect
that. Which is beyond ridiculous. And I'm amazed when people say, okay, the onus lies on the Prime Minister. I mean, the accusation has been that there has been a corruption.
No, people don't say that. Hang on. The court has been saying that.
Well,
remember that.
Saying is this is beyond ridiculous that it's suggesting.
No, don't use this kind of language.
No, I mean, there are two of thoughts on the bar. It has been very clearly established that beyond 2006, you know, before 2006, the possession of the properties, i.e. these flats in London, have to be proved by the PTI. So the Prime Minister's family has been all along saying that the flats were acquired, and here are the proof in 2006. Beyond that, it's for the PTI and their owners to prove it, that no, it was in 80s and in 90s. Now, anyway, that is another debate. But my point about today is, you know, the PTI's interesting comment was, another political statement was made by their spokesperson, Naimullah, who said that, now it was a political case. Okay, if it was a political case, that why then you went to court,
right,
if you do not have a legal standing? That was also, you know, contradicting themselves and their strategy and casting some doubt overall whether they can have any legal standpoint in the court of law.
Right.
And the third important point...
I'll come to the third point, but I have to actually move forward for a second. Tell me, now what happens? Is PTI going to write to NAB, or is it going to file a reference with NAB so that Hudaybiyah Paper Mills is opened again?
First of all, it is a fact that there was a divergent opinion. I mean, I want to make it clear.
On the bench?
There was a divergence of opinion on the question of onus.
Can you quantify that divergence? How many were actually believing, how many of the honorable judges were believing that onus is on PTI?
These divergence of opinion is not a part of, these were propounded in their remarks and observations. Mm-hmm. So we cannot quote them as a permanent opinion or a judgment or an order.
I'm not asking you to give me an assessment that it is a permanent opinion. I'm asking you, what was your hunch?
I think half
and half.
You can say almost. Divergent opinions have been coming from different judges of different members of the same bench.
But is it not the responsibility of the court to act as a contrarian, to actually oppose your point of view so that they get the best of opinion possible or best of the evidence possible?
Court says, even a judge says that one should not rely or one should not deduce any conclusion or result on the basis of their remarks or observations. Mm-hmm. So this is a basic principle.
So we cannot say that there was a divergent.
You can say that there were divergence of opinion, but you can't deduce a conclusion.
But it is
that yes.
It is a deduction and it is a conclusion that there is a divergent opinion, because you are actually surmising this because of the comments coming from.
I am repeating that stance. There is divergence of opinion, but you can't take it as a conclusion or a final decision or a final judgment.
Are convinced by the very statement that you are saying that one should not be using to draw a conclusion. I'm not saying that.
I mean, even judge used to say
can
that.
Can we qualify further and say that there was actually cross-questioning on the matter?
Yes.
Or there was a debate on the matter rather than divergence.
The basic fact is that, as my friend Zegam Saab has already said, that I'm quite agree with you with Zegam Saab that this proceeding is this constitutional petition is being heard under Article 184, that is a public litigation case, we are under a public interest litigation or a case of public importance is being brought before the court.
Right.
So the fact is that all the matter and the whole the basis of the case makes it a criminal case. Right. I mean, it should have been put before a criminal court or an inquiry commission or a investigative commission or a judicial commission.
It doesn't want an inquiry commission.
PTI, what PTI wants is that they want to deduce or they want to divert the attention or divert the legal course of the case towards Article 62 and 63 of the Constitution.
Okay.
Based
on the statements. Of Prime Minister, actually, by trying to actually point out that there is a contradiction there.
Exactly, his statement.
And that's why the Honorable Court said that, and that was quite surreal, that the Honorable Court actually observed that if Article 62 is applied, there will be only one man standing,
Siraj ul Haq.
And within 5 minutes, he was before the cameras. As if he didn't realize that there was innate sarcasm in the comment.
But I was very much there in the courtroom. Okay. At that time, and soon after passing these remarks, Justice Asif Saeed Khan Khosa realized that he has made a very serious statement, and he said all these things are being being said in a very lighter moment.
Innate sarcasm in the statement, right?
Yes, there was.
So this matter about Hudaybiyah paper mills, is it really that irrelevant to the proceedings of the court as we deduce today, Zahram Saab? Because if you are trying to prove that something was bought and something was bought before the statement says it was bought, there has to be a money trail. And is it the method in the madness that counts? Hudaybiyah paper mills was how the money actually landed there?
I think it all shows the confusion surrounding the whole case, the legal confusion. So it appears that court has not set the fence for itself, delimited the case, are set the boundary of the case. Mm-hmm. And as we are discussing, we ourselves are not clear about some of the basic issues regarding the case.
And are we not?
Of course we are not. For example, I mean, what can be more important than the onus of proof?
Mm-hmm.
This is one of the most
basic
today,
things. But today, that matter was settled one way at least.
We don't know.
It was clearly stated.
Yes.
It is on the PTI. PTI's counsel.
It appears that today, court has taken this kind of direction.
Mm-hmm.
And the onus may be on the prosecution, mm-hmm. on the accuser, to prove, to bring evidences, and they have failed to bring any evidence.
Okay.
Hudaybiyah paper mill, I don't know. That does not appear directly linked. Mm-hmm. But since it has come up and court is sending it, wants to send it back to NAB. Mm-hmm. And remember what court said about NAB just, I think, a couple of days ago.
Mm-hmm.
So that was quite an indictment.
That was quite an indictment. But at this moment, regardless, is it not important to actually move along with the case and keep on following the track, whatever is developing at this moment, so that instead of actually discrediting any argument, thinking that there might be some matter to it?
I think the court should focus, and we should all
focus. I'm not talking about the court. I'm talking about us, our opinion, because we are, at this moment, actually, we are trying not to discuss the nitty-gritty, the way it is, of the merits of the case at this moment.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm saying is, it is the court of public opinion. Is it not important to make not to make a final decision at this moment?
But you know, it's not just one court. Mm-hmm. This case is in so many courts
that
because
is.
this case is used politically.
Mm-hmm.
This case is more political than legal.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, on this case, there are public meetings going on at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Where politicians are mainly discussing this case.
Mm-hmm.
We are nearing the next elections.
Mm-hmm.
So it has become politically very important.
We still have 1.5 years.
Less than
between now and the next election.
One and year and 3 months maybe.
No, 6 months.
Six months.
The government maybe actually took office in June. I remember that. So we have 6 months. But let me take this question of Hudaybiyah paper mills to Jana Jagdishab. Jana Jagdishab, if the court indeed directs NAB to open it, or if PTI approaches NAB to reopen the case, are you going to take this position that it is passed and closed transaction, or you will not have any problem with that at all?
Well, you're talking about a speculative
situation. No, it is not a speculation.
Yeah,
there is a clear indicator that this is the direction where we are moving.
Yeah, if it is moved, let's don't jump the gun.
We are not jumping the gun. I'm asking you.
Yeah, if I'm not going to tell you the strategy, what are we are going to adopt when the case is moved. So wait, they move the case, wait, it comes
you're
to
You're not going
front
to tell me
name.
Because you don't know or
no,
because
I
you won't
No, I don't want
tell.
To discuss, the legal strategy, what we are going to adopt. And you said and you suggested that whether we would treat it as a shut case or something that is kind of, the case that has no relevance in today's world. But what I'm saying is that, for me, I cannot say something on speculation. A, the case
but
is
I'm
not
moved. Not asking you to
B,
testify at this
okay,
moment.
However, I just
an opinion.
Something is very much going on in Supreme Court. In the next 2 days, you will hear more about, what has been said and what is our rebuttal.
And I'm not asking about the court at this moment. I'm talking about NAB.
Okay, wait till it
There's
comes to NAB.
There's a difference between NAB
yeah,
and
Wait till it comes to NAB and you'll find out our strategy as well, okay. What we will adopt. But now it's in the realm
so
of speculation.
Are you improvising at this moment that you make the strategy as
okay.
you go along?
You cannot, force me to say something which is very
you
much
have
in
said
the realm
plenty.
Of speculation.
You don't realize
okay.
you have said
but
plenty
just
already.
Let me point out what my honorable colleague said about the courts that we are talking about. Of course, we have no problem legally, we have a sound case, and inshallah, we would win this case in the court of law. Mm-hmm. Second, there is the public perception court. Very much, we have gone, we have explained to our people, to the electorates, that what is the reality and what is the fact. So far, alhamdulillah, they have trusted through all these elections. So far, they have supported the PML News version on anything from Panama to our governance. The third is history.
Hang on. You never actually went into an election discussing Panama Papers.
Yeah, but we have been discussing all along in the elections, any elections.
No, you can say that your performance is being appreciated.
No,
you cannot say
no.
that this has
PTI
been resolved by the
has
People's
been,
Court.
PTI has been raising and flagging every by-election, and they're talking about corruption of the alleged corruption of the PML Noon, including a Panama case. But the people have rejected that narrative, and they have again returned as successful in every by-election so far held.
Okay.
So the public perception is very important.
That,
yes.
This is one point.
The third.
The
and the third is being morally on high ground. That is the history's judgment. We really believe that we are for good governance, for clean governance. So it's very important that A, the names of the prime ministers, family are cleared through this court. And on the history side of the history, we are on the
prime
right
minister
side of
actually
the
actually volunteered at this
right,
start.
Yes.
So
that is also very
that away
important
from
for us. So it's not just a legal.
I cannot take that away from you. But
yeah.
here's another very
want,
important question
I just
that
let
I have
the,
to
one
ask.
One sentence. So it's just not the legal side of the argument that we need to win or we are winning it, but also, the moral high ground that we have been claiming all along. We want to reestablish so the name is clear and we go back to the people that here,
okay.
We stand for clean governance.
Talking about high moral ground, why do you think that the government actually felt necessity to actually bring in an ordinance on plea bargaining now?
Just well, not. Plea bargain is something.
And is it going to provide you any relief in Panama Papers?
Well, it has nothing to do with the Panama paper. Panama is a one exclusive case that is going on. It is generally with the plea bargain. So many political parties and the public opinion turned against this particular case that was, the corruption case in Balochistan. And given government's commitment and the PML Noon's commitment that you should not allow somebody to get away with the
murder.
Plunder while still he can be qualified to have reapply for a job here. He can be hired and he can go back to his usual business of whatever his official position is. So simply, it's unacceptable that have plundered the wealth and the exchequer, yet you become a senator or MP or a bureaucrat. So that was the lacuna in that law.
In the system that was
yes.
very kindly pointed out that, by the courts rather than the government itself.
Well, the
and
government
you had to follow
is
suit.
Very much committed. This is why government has done
it very quickly because we understand the veracity of it.
So I take your word for it that it is not going to have an effect on Panama Papers. But is it? Kamran Hansab, this ordinance?
No, sir, it is not directly linked with Panama Papers, but...
Can you identify any of the senior leadership across any political, across the political spectrum who might have actually benefited from plea bargaining in the past?
I don't think there is any politician or any, parliamentarian.
This ring.
There has been an admiral of Pakistan naval force. Admiral Mansoor, who was indicted.
But I'm talking about people who are relevant at this moment in the political structure. I'm talking about leadership of political parties, PTI, PMLN, People's Party. And I'm talking about other people who might be holding higher public offices.
They won't be directly involved, but their front man or front persons, they must be in that list. But Farooq, one thing is very important that, as you have already said, that it was pointed out by the courts that this plea bargain is against the social justice, it is against the normal norms of justice. Mm-hmm. So, and you know that this legislation was very much part of the NAB ordinance since its inception of that ordinance.
I mean,
General Pervez Musharraf invented the NAB ordinance, and this plea bargain that is incorporated in section 25, I think section 25 of the NAB ordinance, mm-hmm. it is very much there. Since the very inception of this legislation, and nobody pointed out, no political party pointed out. Even I'm sorry to say that courts are now pointing out.
Then you'll have to appreciate the fact that the government actually has taken that advice.
Exactly.
Had it been People's Party's time, maybe
sir,
perhaps
what has been done,
nothing would have
what
moved.
The new legislation, which is being introduced by the party of Achak Zai Saab.
Remember, there are two parties.
You're not Jamali.
okay.
So that, but it will not make any difference. I mean, there was a punishment of disqualification. That was, I think, for a certain period of time, for 10 years. Mm-hmm. Now they have made it a permanent ineligibility for holding a public office or a office of the government. Mm-hmm. So. For a looter and plunderer of national wealth, I think that this punishment, this lifetime punishment, is not enough. It is not a stern or a strict punishment.
It is not big enough, or it is not enough at all.
Not big enough. I think there should be stern and strict punishment.
Okay.
What will happen, Farooq? If I am rendered disqualified under a plea bargain deal, then my son, my wife, my sister will come into step forward, and I will arrange office portfolios for them with the plundered money.
So that kind of law cannot be developed because
I don't think
a guilty man, wife of a guilty man, cannot be punished for his guilt.
Exactly.
It never happened nowhere in the world.
So unless
you are going to follow the argument given by Donald Trump that if you cannot kill a terrorist, kill his family. That is another thing. Otherwise, this doesn't happen in any legal.
That's system. Why I am asking that there is still a lacuna that family that plundered money will be benefited. This legislation won't serve any purpose.
So you are saying that
the judges who were conducting the case against plea bargain. I mean, it was being assumed that government is withdrawing that legislation. The plea bargain section will be deleted from that ordinance, and now there will be no. Mean way for the plunderer and looter of national
wealth. No compromise between
but
the two.
Yeah. You have compromised, and I am sorry to say
no,
that
I didn't
legislation.
Say compromised. There is no compromise between the two positions. I was interpreting your words. I wasn't saying that the government or anybody has compromised. I think the system has to move forward, and there has to be a reform inch by inch. Maybe it is that. But coming back to the original question, that is it going to have any kind of impact on Panama Papers or any other politician who might be actually in among the front runners of any party?
I don't think this new legislation has any implications on the Panama case or any recent case against any politician. I think government was responding to harsh criticism from the court, from media, and also from public regarding the conduct of the NAP. So there is a problem of trust on NAP, but there's also a problem in trust on the government regarding the issue of accountability. And I think both the government and the opposition are not serious on the issue of accountability.
Okay.
Plea bargain is there in all over the world, even in other criminal laws as well. Plea bargain simply means that prosecutor and defendant, they can make an agreement where the accused pleads guilty and in return he or she gets some concessions. Well, he doesn't go scot-free, but he gets some concessions.
Why can't this concession actually be about him going back to his home rather than keeping some money as well?
I think the opinion at the moment
freedom is good enough. I mean, if I have actually plundered, if I have looted the economy of the country, the exchequer, and caught, then if I am allowed going scot-free, that should be good enough.
Well, it gets some concessions the world over. You don't go scot-free. If normally you get 40 years, in this case you may get 20 years, but you won't go scot-free.
Okay.
And you're not allowed to keep any looted money with yourself.
Okay.
But I frankly, I believe there's no sincerity on part
of that government. That didn't happen in the, Quetta corruption case. That actually was the trigger of all this debate, where one finance secretary actually was found hoarding a lot of money inside his house. And then it was appreciated. It dawned on the authorities that he has a lot of money beyond that sum that was found from his house as well.
Because the public...
And what he has returned is only a pittance compared to the original amount.
Only a pittance, only a pittance.
Plundered amount is in billions and the returned amount is only millions.
And even if one returns all the plundered money, that should not be sufficient. And the harm that he has done to the common people, look, it was the public money. It was the money meant for schools. It was the money meant for hospitals and roads.
But that is an argument for justice, not for plea bargaining, is it?
Well, plea bargain is not a substitute for justice. It is a part of the system of justice in which the defendant gets some mitigation.
But
we feel, and everybody in Pakistan feels, including the court,
the state gets some mitigation.
Yes. Here the state gets some mitigation, a pittance, and the person who has done so much harm to this poor country, he goes scot-free.
So that has been fine-tuned now?
I think the government and the opposition needs to do a lot more.
Okay.
And they need to...
But doesn't it actually nag you that why an ordinance? Why not actually introduce a bill in the court, in the parliament?
That shows the lack of seriousness on part of our political elite, on
political
part of
elite
our opposition.
Or a trust deficit between political parties?
I don't think it's just a matter of trust deficit. Be a trust deficit.
If you know that People's Party is going to take a very strong exception to it, and they have the leader of opposition... In one house.
Look, People's Party.
It rules the other house.
Look, People's Party and the PMLN government, they signed on the Charter of Democracy. And if you allow me to read a few lines, in 13D of the Charter of Democracy, the two parties committed to replace what they called politically motivated NAB with an independent accountability commission. Right? But they have never done it. So
they also talked about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in the society, but that never happened, and
of course
that is never going to be introduced. Janet Jagdish sir, why an ordinance? Why not a proper bill in the parliament?
I think it will be presented this week. Why ordinance? Because the government wanted to show that it's a resolve, that there is a political will, and wanted to send a message to anybody, particularly the political forces, that no political bargaining would be allowed on this ordinance regarding other issues, because this is very much normal that when you have any bill moved in the parliament, the rest of the political parties try to have a, you know, use as a leverage and extract concessions.
You have simple majority in the parliament.
Yeah, but not in the Senate.
In the National Assembly.
Not in the Senate. So this is why, but you know, the bill will be moved very soon, you know, this week.
Are you forcing the hand of democracy?
Well,
are you forcing the hand of the parliament?
Well, I mean, the gravity, if we believe that the situation was grave, that, you know, the plea bargain, the outcry, the public interest, the public opinion was so, agitated, and something has to be done, and also how the government felt it with this Quetta case of the Raisani by the NAB, and here you got immediate reaction and resoluteness by the government. This is why we had this instrument used.
Right. So let us come back to Panama Papers, Kamran Hansen, and tell me, what do you expect is going to happen in coming days? I mean, tomorrow, day after tomorrow.
I mean, today you have also quoted that Hudaybiyah paper mills is being brought, and that it was a past and closed transaction. But
there is a very interesting observation, and I will want you. Thank you very much for actually pointing it out, because I'm keen to know. There was this observation coming from the head of the bench, Justice Khosa, who especially said that if Hudaybiyah paper mill is actually sent back to NAB or elsewhere, then the justification of hearing this case on the basis of Article 184 is compromised and the court cannot do it. Elaborate that. And then he said, if it is heard simultaneously, or if both cases are not separated, then the proceeding is going to be muddy. What exactly does it mean?
Again, I will say that these were remarks and observations, and I should not be used to deduce a conclusion that yes, court is going to do this or court is going to do that. I think Hudaybiyah paper mills has been a part of money trail with regard to the money which has been siphoned off to the offshore companies by Sharif family. So that is why the PTI counsel Naeem Bukhari says that the Hudaybiyah paper mills case should be reopened. And why he's forcing the court to reopen this case? Because he says that when that case was heard by the High Court, it was two-member bench by the High Court, and one judge decided that it should be quashed, and the other one decided that it should be heard furthermore. And it was sent back to the trial court, and the trial court, hearing that case, the trial court squashed the whole case. So the role of NAB chairman was very very critical at that moment, because he did not file any appeal against that quashment. So Naeem Bukhari says that Chairman NAB at that time, whosoever was occupying the slot of chairman at that time, he did not perform his constitutional duty, and the result was that the Sharif family was rendered acquitted in that case. So he is forcing this court to reopen, and ask the Chairman NAB to file an appeal before the trial court, so that. The trail of money should be detected.
No, but you have qualified the entire development, but you haven't told me the actual thing. I'm sorry, I lost voice for a bit because of a technical glitch, so I couldn't ask you a question. And you already decided somehow that the money that was somehow siphoned off was
I'm talking about the allegation and the contents of the petition. The case before the court right now.
Article 184. Public interest case and Hudaybiyah papers mill. If it is separated, then the entire hearing goes in south. It doesn't go
obviously. North. I mean, and these proceedings will be done. We will be poles apart. I mean, we will be poles apart while judging these two cases in parallel terms. I mean, as I already said, that Hudaybiyah paper mills is now a past and closed transaction. I don't think that the record with the of Hudaybiyah paper mills will be available with the NAB authorities or not.
Okay.
Because in past.
And just to qualify another very interesting point, while you were talking about this reference and this quashment, it happened in 2011, I believe, right? Mm.
And
at that time, PMLN was not ruling the country, was it?
No, I don't think.
That is quite interesting. So, what do you make of these two stances?
Well, it's very clear that all of these things need investigation.
Okay.
And court cannot carry out an investigation.
It cannot.
While sitting on the bench, honorable judges could ask questions but can't carry out investigation.
Okay.
For that, they need the help of the investigative authorities.
Mm-hmm.
And how they do it without forming a commission.
No, but
to me, it appears that.
But these two observations
both are
on both. One side, we are saying that send it to the NAB, right? The Honorable Court is saying that send it to the NAB. On the other side, they're saying if it is sent to the NAB, then that compromises this hearing, this court, this case, actually, right? And on the other side, they're saying that if it continues without separation, the two, Panama Papers and Hudaybiyah Papers Mill, then it will keep on muddying the discussion or discourse.
You see, this is the catch-22 situation. It shows the confusion around the case.
Okay.
Because it's a criminal, the criminal nature of the case and the nature of hearing that is going on in the court.
Mm-hmm.
Without using the services of the investigative agencies,
okay.
Now apparently court needs services of these investigative agencies.
So why is it that Imran Khan Saab doesn't accept an inquiry commission? That could have solved all these problems.
Because he thinks the courts.
I hope I said Imran Khan, not Kamran Khan. Okay.
I think because
he looked provoked.
He wants That's the judges. Right. He wants the judges to convict the Prime Minister right away.
Okay. So they have already made the decision.
They have made the decision in their court.
They want to hear the Supreme Court saying the same thing. Jana Chakzai Saab, once again, speculative or not, I need a formal answer. Will your party or your government favor separating the two cases? Will it support the cause of an inquiry commission? Or it would want the same kind of muddying of discussion as was pointed out by the Honorable Court?
So all questions raised by the counsel of the PTI and all the remarks of the CUP by Honorable Judges will be answered in next couple of days, next 48 hours.
When your counsel actually
Yes,
gives,
when
yes.
he takes the floor. So I would suggest, you know, we should wait for that. It's too early to say something well when the counsel
Look,
has not
Look, we always heard
it.
That we shouldn't discuss now, the merits of a sub judice case because it affects the proceedings. I never heard that you cannot question a strategy of a political party or
yeah,
a party in the case.
Yeah, you can question, but you know.
You are asking me as if
yeah, this is
that is also sub judice.
Yeah, no, it's not sub judice. You're talking about something that is still in the future where nothing, you know, we would have a formal rebuttal. The whole world would know that. And you want me to share with that rebuttal 48
no,
hours today.
I'm not
so,
even asking that.
No,
I'm asking
this
you
is not
to give
just
me
one point.
A just hunch, an inclination.
Just one point, you know, you are insisting
would you,
on.
Would, you,
so
would you rather like the separation of the two cases because that makes sense? Or would you actually carry on in the same manner? And then there's this point about inquiry commission. Last time, and let me help you out here. Last time when there was a proposal of inquiry commission, your party was all for it. So are
yeah.
you still all for
well,
it?
Whatever the, you know, the way forward is, we
no,
never
no,
objected as far as the Supreme Court's, you know, this there it was their discretion. We allow, you know, we kind of submitted, you know, that is for the courts to decide whether they want to do it through the old, you know, bench, the new bench, and also they want to form the commission. We never, you know, said or insisted on that was, you know, PTI's stand that they wanted to have a commission. Then they try, you know, withdrew from that demand, and then they said, no, we don't want that. So for us, it's a matter of justice and a matter of law. We want to see the end of it. And that's why Prime Minister voluntarily offered himself, and this is why he's, you know, referring to all the questions even raised by.
I must compliment you. I'm sure that you are a very fine poker player because you know how to stonewall an answer, a question. And you have been doing that for stalling a question for quite some time. But I'm told that we have run short of time. If you want to give us any concluding remarks, kindly do so.
The main argument would remain is that A, whether money laundering has been done for the PTI to prove. B, that the money was ill-gotten, they have to prove. Three, that you know the flats were possessed before 2006, they have to come out with clean evidence, which they have failed so far. And D, if it's a political case, why they went to the court in the first place. So this is, you know, they have to answer. So far, they have failed on all these accounts.
Right. In the end, you give a pithy answer, an articulate answer. But Kavanan Hansap, your conclusion.
Sir, being a court reporter, I can say, I can guess, and I can, deduce a conclusion to this extent that this case is a criminal case, but it is being heard under Article 184.3, which is not a criminal jurisdiction, it is a constitutional jurisdiction. So I think the court is still on the horns of a dilemma. I think I'm no harm. I don't fear in saying that the court is still on the horns of a dilemma. They are unable to decide how to deal with the case.
Is it not that job is why, of the court to actually decide here?
Yes, it is, but
when there is no path, usually the courts actually make it through a judgment, through an observation.
Yes, they are in the process of making that, but the present situation is that a criminal case is being heard in a constitutional jurisdiction, and here is the confusion.
The dilemma remains, and exactly. It is going to be there for a bit. Your conclusion, sir?
I think one thing that is evident is the fact that the lack of credibility and weakness of the institutions of accountability has been exposed. This case should not be with the Supreme Court of Pakistan. It is because the other institutions did not deliver. We should be discussing
either that or it could not satisfy the petitioner. And they were threatening. The other option was lockdown of the entire capital.
Well, NAB did not take up the case anyway. FBR did not take up this case anyway. I think we should be discussing accountability and transparency more.
And that we will. In coming days as well, I'm told that we have to conclude the program here. Zagam Hansap, thank you very much, sir, for your time. Kavanan Hansap, thank you very much as well. Janet Chakzai, sir, thank you very much for your presence. Viewers, you have listened to our participants. This discussion will go on, and tomorrow also we'll be discussing more or less the same case. But let me also refresh the memory, your memory, that so far only PTI's counsel has spoken. The defendant's counsel hasn't even taken up the matter, hasn't started his case. So in coming days we'll see how that goes. And there are other factors, other political players that are still not accounted for. For example, People's Party. At the start, they were very close to the case, but now they are not. In coming days, we are going to try divine which direction they will take as well. Thank you very much for watching us. Take care.